thank everybody for coming today, and I just want to go through and introduce all the panelists. As you guys know, we're going to be talking about criticism in the classroom and critiquing craft, but I have a feeling, based on our last conversation, that this is going to become kind of a weeding river, if you would say that, so we'll see what happens here. I think you guys are in the order I made on my list. That's amazing. Okay, so next to me I have Anya Kivarkis. She's an associate professor of jewelry and metalsmithing at the University of Oregon. Mary, would you like Mary Hallam Pearse?
Sure.
Yes, okay. Associate professor, area chair of jewelry and metals at the University of Georgia. Kim Cridler, studio artist, previous coordinator at the Kohler Arts Center and has taught in various institutions. And then Jeffrey Clancy, on the end, associate professor of metalsmithing and jewelry at the University of Wisconsin Madison. What?
Staring at me.
So everyone stare at Jeffrey as much as possible. So for me personally, the inspiration for kind of putting this panel together is that I have either critiqued with or been critiqued by everyone that is sitting in front of you today.
So she's extracting her revenge.
So my plan was, that now I'm going to put you all on the spot. I know that you guys all have really different approaches to critiquing, and I thought that kind of having this mind meld would be a really interesting experience, mostly for me, and so I'm using you. But anyway, so I just want to get started with a couple questions, and we'll just kind of see where this goes. So I want to start out by asking, what are effective means of critique in the field, in a field that is rooted in history in this contemporary moment?
Just say it again.
Yes.
Sorry.
What are effective means of critique in a field that is rooted in history in a contemporary moment?
Aren't all fields rooted in history?
Mm-hmm. That's my answer, then.
All fields are rooted in history, and if they're useful now, then they have meaning to us as people. Mm-hmm. How's that?
Well, then I guess I would add to that, like, how do you bring that history into the classroom, you know, in a critique, in a dialogue and critique? Like, how do you engage with students in a way that allows for you to talk about a contemporary object that they've made with, you know, with that history, embedding that history then in the class?
I feel like we need a buzzer system.
I know.
I know the answer to that. I mean, that's the conundrum of teaching what someone might say is an antiquated discipline. Mm-hmm. And surely our challenge, if we're practicing craftspeople or metal people or artists, whatever you choose to call it, is to find out, are there things about these old ways of knowing and old ways of doing that are relevant and actually can be applied to today's problems and come up with interesting, novel, creative solutions? Mm-hmm. And that's a great question. I'm not sure. I mean, when I was an educator, from which I have retired, I laid awake at night worrying about, why am I teaching people how to do this really cool thing? Like, mm-hmm. what are they going to do with it? Mm-hmm. I don't know the answer to that.
Like, from a standpoint of practicality, you mean? Or like
from every possible standpoint. Like, what's my responsibility as an educator teaching people how to do things in this specific way? Because what are the practical applications? And fortunately, hopefully, they will come up with their own solutions, because I don't have a solution.
Mm-hmm. But do you build value through practical applications? What do you mean when you say that? I feel like we have to sort that out a little bit. Because
what I'm saying is, you know, the parents come to your class and they're like, what are my kids going to do with this? And I say, they're going to be a better human being.
Yeah.
So there, right? But they're like, no, seriously, are they going to make a living? And then I say, well, David Pye in 1969 said they could get a job somewhere else, like Starbucks, where I worked, so that they can practice this craft as an amateur or someone for the love of it, to continue it into the future. But that's not a very satisfying answer to a parent that's paying tuition.
So do you think that's regionally
motivated? Your parents don't ask you that question?
No, I think Oregon has maybe like a spirit of entrepreneurship that's different than the Midwest, actually. Because I went to school in the Midwest, and then on the East Coast, and then now in Oregon, and each region has its own set of concerns.
Mm-hmm. Will you guys pick up a little?
Yeah, it's really hard to project in the outside.
Project and communicate.
So we're starting to get into after they graduate, what are they going to do professionally? But I'm curious about what's the point of
teaching this
in general?
But I almost feel like this is related to a conversation that started. I'm almost trying to retrieve the conversation that we left off in the last panel. What was it about? Not, and it wasn't necessarily about the specificity of the discipline. What was it about? I feel like we, is anyone there with me? It's like something we could, a thread of that we could pull into that. I mean, I feel like also your question I would want to sort out in terms of pedagogy and how you build curriculum and think about ideas and critique, because those are related, obviously, but different in terms of how you conceive of them.
Right.
So I do feel like, obviously, the field is framed by history in different ways than maybe, or maybe it's framed by more of a distant history than sculpture is, for example, in terms of what people are responding to, maybe. But I don't know what that means in terms of critique yet. I'm thinking about, maybe, I mean, it goes back to the idea of critical potential. We were talking about teapots in the 90s, right? Being these narrative teapots.
Right.
And they're selecting,
<today. 90s
laughs> selecting a format.
That's what you're going to bring in from the last
panel. That's what I'm thinking about, yeah.
All right.
But, you know, the idea that, you know, there are those teapots and there are these historical teapots and these, and, you know, in some way they're all connected in a spectrum of time. Maybe I need you to, I didn't fully understand actually, Beth, what you, but I was curious about what you're saying, because in some way, like if we're talking about critique, like how do you sort and distinguish, and how, in some way you were saying, like, maybe it's not a matter of assessment, but critique is a matter of assessment or judgment or context. I mean, there's so many ways to think about critique also, you know.
Yeah.
So
maybe that's a good place to start.
I think that is, like, the different ways of thinking
about
critique.
Yeah, let's talk about that. Yeah, let's talk about that.
Yeah, because I'm curious. You have had critiques with all of us.
Now it's my turn to respond.
Right, yeah. But, like, I'm curious the way you all critique. Like, what's in, what do you find valuable in that?
And they're all sitting
there. Yeah, all of your students are in the back.
Graduate students are just waiting.
Oh, those are
your
graduate
students?
I
like the idea of rupturing this plane, though, I have to say. Like, I don't want to perform a conversation for people. I feel like the other one was reciprocal. I would love for this one to also be.
Yeah, but maybe they're closer.
I feel like you feel distant. Can we come closer, though?
Well, they're trying to film it, so we have to be at a certain...
Well, can't they come closer? Is that too much to ask?
Can you guys come closer? Yeah, it feels weird.
It does feel weird. I don't like it.
Yeah, I feel like we're performing. I do not like performing conversation.
You should have just stayed in a circle.
Yeah, but then they couldn't film it
better.
Well, they're just really cool.
Thank you. This feels really nice.
It's better. Thank you.
Okay.
We were told
we can't move our five chairs. We need to move closer.
Because we're being filmed.
No, we have to stay behind them.
So maybe we should start by everyone articulating the way that they approach critique.
I mean, it's different for different types of classes and different types of assignments. When I teach advanced metalsmithing classes, whether it's a pewter smithing class or the hollowware class we just had this past semester, students were given technical assignments, you know, like make a seamed vessel, you know, make a sunk bowl, this, that, and the other thing. And the objective was very clear, and so the critique could actually happen, like, you know, this is not done properly.
Right.
But with the grads in their own studio work, I mean, I don't think, even when it's a finished piece, I don't even feel like there's much of a critique or room for critique, as often the work is a critique. And so it becomes a conversation, a dialogue. I think contemporary art practices are so much about context that critique doesn't really, it doesn't really exist, you know, and it kind of hasn't since like modernism. You know, and that there was, it's like, who's to say this is the right way to do it or the wrong way to do it? And we were sort of talking about that earlier in terms of, you know, with my beginning students, I always use this term and they sort of laugh, but I'm actually kind of interested in it. But when you teach them how to solder, and so we're in critique looking at these technical samples, and I'm like, oh, your soldering is so expressive, you know? And that's you know, pointing out the fact that maybe it's not right. But there could be something interesting about expressive soldering, you know, if handled correctly, you know, so like, what are we actually critiquing then? You know, so it just becomes a dialogue, I guess, of, you know, what happened and could happen, you know, of potentials, you know, like, and I also, I don't know, I don't want to, I give my opinion, like, I'm not afraid to share that, and hopefully they know how to suss that out in terms of this is just an opinion, not so much of a criticism, but, you know, just because I don't like something doesn't mean it's not great.
Yeah.
And I don't want to get in the way of that.
You know, the way I think about critique, I mean, you could, again, like, sort it out, you know, that there's critique related to considering its context and thinking about it speculatively within that context, and I feel like that's part of what you're talking yeah. about. But I do still feel like that's a form of critique. Mm-hmm. I feel like we will come back to that idea. And you're talking about taste and judgment, and so in that way you don't feel like the person who's appropriate to judge based on taste, maybe, or even the idea of what's right. I mean, it's funny that when you're looking at a technical sample, you're like, I know what's correct, but when you're looking at maybe speculative graduate work, you're like, maybe I don't critique or judge there. But to me, actually, I feel much more deep in my inquiry with critique at the graduate level than I do with undergrads, who I don't ever talk about technical samples with in a critique conversation, actually. So I'm just really interested in all the space between all of those things. I mean, that's mm-hmm. a lot of space to cover.
I want to add something to that in terms of space to cover, because something I think about often is that we don't have a model. We're not taught how to critique. We learn it through osmosis.
Mm-hmm. Why? Well, through experience.
Through experience, yeah. Right. But like in other practices, theater, dance, and other practices, they actually have very specific models. There are numbers of them within those disciplines, but very specific models in which they use and they teach to critique. So I do think it's the way in which we're all expected to critique work in art school, but we're learning it through experience and osmosis. We're not, I have a problem with that, actually. Because some people, I'm not so sure, maybe they're not really good at critiques.
I think doing the work is the experience that you learn from. So when I'm in a critique with mm-hmm. students, they've already learned what they needed to learn by trying it. You learn from doing.
Right.
And that's both conceptual to me and physical. It's mm-hmm. skill and concept. Mm-hmm. And so for me, critique is about training the other students to learn how to describe objects, which sounds very simple. But, you know, if I can sit down and describe an object, if a student can sit down and develop language to talk about even the formal qualities mm-hmm. of an object, mm-hmm. and this is super elemental, like this is the most basic level.
Yep.
It's like, okay, you told me about the line weight and the structure and the color and the texture, and then this is cheesy. I'm like, and how does it make you feel? And then they actually go into their brain and they come up with, you know, analogous information mm-hmm. and they relate things to it from their own personal experience. Mm-hmm. And there's like a moment where they realize that the things that they can affect in the world, the things they can introduce in the world through their hands, can affect how people feel and think. And there's like, it's kind of a nice moment, even though I know it's really basic, but mm-hmm. I still approach it that way. I think it's about quizzing the other students to come up with appropriate language to describe both what they're thinking and what they're feeling.
I agree.
Because it's not about the person who made it at that point. They know.
Right.
It's, right?
Yeah, it's done. Right. Right. But, and I agree with that, but I don't think that everyone approaches critique that way, you know?
No, yeah. So no, I'm not saying everyone should.
Right.
It just seems like a good place to start.
I absolutely do think it's a good place to start, because I feel like that's what I'm doing in the classroom, is giving the students a vocabulary to help them learn to evaluate these objects, either formally or conceptually.
The science of sensitive knowing is like Alexander Baumgarten's description of aesthetics, and I still feel like there's so much potential in that. Mm.
Mm. Say that again?
Baumgarten, I think he was German, like 1800s, but he called aesthetics the science of sensitive knowing. So that it wasn't, well, clearly I'm not like a theory-based person, so I have to have other faculties with which to appreciate the built environment. Uh-huh.
I was just talking earlier to Kim about how I want the world to stop when I want to speculate on something. Like, can we be silent for a moment so I can think?
90 teapots. I'm still stuck on that.
I have to.
So I guess I'm curious, now that you guys have kind of all talked about the ways that you, like, you know.
Is there enough?
If we can go more.
Do you want to
pose it.
No, did you feel like you got to kind of articulate how you approach critique?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's different for, you know, undergrad and grad, and definitely when I'm giving a technical assignment, you know, mm-hmm. it's very much like helping them figure out that language in which to talk about the work, you know, and I always start, all right, state the facts.
Good, yeah.
State the facts, you know, and then I'm like, all right, let's ask, do you have any questions?
Yeah.
And then I'm like, okay. So ask the the person who made it, if they had questions, and then the rest of the students, all right, what questions do you all have based on what you're hearing?
But I kind of want to go back to what you said, too, because you were taking apart her original question, which conflates informing critical or theoretical information just at the critique, but surely it doesn't happen there as much as it might happen in the assignment itself, or the build-up to the work, or right. the context of the class. Mm-hmm.
So that was kind of where I was going to ask, and we can maybe build off this. So we were talked on the way here about the idea of the assignment being kind of that moment where, as an instructor, you can kind of interject ideas of concept and then also technique, potentially, depending on the course. And then I'm wondering how... I just think critique is like a critical moment in which you can kind of like build momentum for a student, you can build momentum for a class. Like there are only a few places that you really get to intervene in the course in this kind of diplomatic, everyone's their way. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering like how you engage with like technique, potentially history, contemporary art, like how do you utilize that moment of critique and having your whole course together to kind of make those moments happen and the connections and kind of propel them forward in their practice.
You know, as I'm thinking about this, you know, again, like thinking broadly and then trying to sort it out, but I think about grad students and thinking about being much more deep and how I think about critique related to them, mm-hmm. with you guys, for example. I didn't think about critique as being in critique, that's where we critique. I mean, what we did actually, it was in terms of building pedagogy. When we were in seminar, we were kind of examining each other's work through clusters of readings. So we would have four readings, and I would specifically and strategically do this, four readings that would relate to Courtney's work and four readings that might relate to your work. And then we'd look at a body of research and consider each other's practices through these bodies of research. And so everyone's kind of focused on somebody for a week, you know, and I feel like that actually, those conversations built critical potentials just as much as critique did, and maybe even more. Like one was maybe speculative and maybe one was evaluative, because and I'm curious like where people land even in terms of critique as evaluative, but I feel like that was really important in terms of building context for ways of thinking about ideas, mm-hmm. and then how they manifest into objects and spaces and whatever the work manifested as.
And this is a way in general kind of to like speak about pedagogy in a focused way, but I mean, we can open up a conversation with that.
And I can think at all levels too, because I think about, you know, if you're talking about intro students, for example, or giving a technical assignment, I never really like sit down with a group of students and talk about something technical. But when you said that, I mean, I think about the way that the problem of craft is that we work on materials and erase the tracks of the process instead of, you know, engage the idea of facture, which would be like revealing the tracks of the process or something about the process. You know, ideas are embedded in that process of making something. So yeah, like could we assign technical projects in a way that maybe examines that in a kind of through a spectrum, you know, and the idea of it being expressive, and maybe it's wrong. You're saying, you know, I'm just interested in that idea.
Well, I think like when so just to like unpack this technical thing, when I do it, it's purely just like I can sleep at night knowing that I showed them how to solder correctly, mm-hmm. right? And now they have to reproduce this experience. And I think just because of the different skill levels, or maybe use of time is what it really is these days, you get a range of finished product, right? And so you can see those tracks in different ways, meaning who finished theirs more, spent more time finishing versus not, you know, or who did it correctly, or who actually paid attention to the demo. And that's, you know, like that's purely that sort of critical or being critical of that process is just, it's really a demonstration, you know?
Yeah.
And so, you know, I mean, and that's, I guess, the other thing I keep thinking about too now. It's like the difference between being of a critique and being critical and sort of the nuances of that, mm-hmm. you know, and I guess as it's part of that demonstration, you know, mm-hmm. so.
Is anyone interested in furthering the conversation, sort of looking at critique or criticism outside of academia?
Yes.
Craft?
Yeah, you got an idea.
To derail your...
Please, let's
go. No,
go
for it.
Yeah.
This is... Yeah.
I'm just... Well, that's it.
What are you thinking?
In terms of a matriculation process? Like, just talking about it more generally in terms of, like, is there a difference between... critical thinking
in looking at works that are using traditional craft process versus, you know, product design versus contemporary art. Like, I don't know. Like, I don't know if that's of interest or I don't want to.
Like, in the sense of different ways of attacking different disciplines, or how do you?
I don't know. Yeah, what's the question? I don't know if you want to take any of those threads. I'm just wondering if, like, instead of being, not instead of, but and, mm-hmm. also, can we look at it in the broader context when you're looking at objects yeah. that are existing outside of academia? How do you?
How you evaluate
my
that?
Life is in academia only.
But do you mean just like
well,
going to an?
No, I'm totally kidding. It's like.
Do you mean encountering works of art and craft and design
that
outside
of? I thought the conversation would also include that a little bit. So
can you give us an example?
Yeah, I want to understand this through examples. Exactly.
You're getting. I mean, because like works are in an institution, can you still ask questions about their content? Or
well,
validity?
Can you?
Oh yeah, of course. But I mean, did you?
So how do you do that? Do you apply the same judgment?
I just don't tell anybody that I'm asking these questions, and I don't go back.
Take yeah. it. You just like so spit on the ground, and then you just storm out, and that's it. You slam the door.
That's it. So one of the things I learned in grad school is if you take the same object and you put it in front of different people from different things, you have completely different conversations. So. Yeah. 90s teapots, you take a 90s teapot, okay. and you put it in front of painters, you're going to have this very specific dialogue and look at it a certain way. You put it in front of metalsmiths, you put it in all these
yeah.
different contexts.
Your mother.
Is that kind of what you're talking about?
I was just wondering, like, yeah, just like if we can
expand
the
conversation, yeah.
conversation
yeah, yeah.
to be about yeah. criticism in general about mm-hmm. crafted objects.
And I don't know if mm-hmm. this adds to that in any way or relates to it, but I'm also thinking about how sort of the performance of critiquing something works in these contexts. Obviously in a classroom setting you're performing a certain yeah. kind of critique and you're modeling it. How does that happen when you're in a museum context or a gallery context? Are you also then as someone who's wearing the hat of a critic in that context, what are you performing? What are you projecting about that work? What is that? I mean, how do you think about those things as well? I mean, these are big questions, mm-hmm. yeah. but I feel like performance is such a huge part of it, too, for better or
that's
worse.
Interesting. That is interesting. I feel like when I'm teaching, I'm performing, and when I'm going to view work, I'm experiencing, and I appreciate that I can experience and not
yeah.
perform.
Yeah, yeah, right? Yeah, like I turn off.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But I think there's potential, too, in the, yeah. like, as someone who's maybe dictating
you're
or,
assessing.
Like, facilitating a critique, right, there's, like, a potential to make better visual, or, like, make visual consumers in a different way of your students. So, like, they're going to be at a museum and, like, view things differently, mm-hmm. potentially. So that's why I think there's, like, I'm interested in that sense of responsibility or, like, how moderating that or performing that acting critique kind of helps to mold a mind and make them look at work differently, potentially, because of how you're helping them, like, analyze the corner of something or fix the solder seam. Or. And I think, too, that, like, you learn how to teach in, like, you have to learn how to teach while you're teaching. And there's no kind of book on, like, critique and craft. And so that's kind of why I was thinking this was, like, a good place to start that conversation, because there isn't a model for us within which to operate from, besides, you know, seeing how other people operate and crit and then trying to mine from it what works for you.
You know, I think I'm probably guilty of applying art criticism to craft-based objects.
It's not so secret, is it? Yeah.
So I'm wondering. I mean, I there's
why
a big
guilty?
Part of me.
But why guilt? What do you
mean? I mean, I feel like they're also distinct fields, you know, and I think yeah. that. But I do think there are things that you apply across the board,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
regardless. I feel like, you know.
It's very practical.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Like, why wouldn't you use whatever tool you could find? I mean, considering that it has a different origin and being conscious of that, I don't know, I still think that's relevant.
But actually, if I think about it, to extend it to product design, for example, I critique design differently than I critique art.
How so?
I think about use value in a different way when I'm critiquing product design, and maybe the craft is like the space in between, or that, you know, I feel, and I could be really wrong, this is a long time ago, but I saw something Ethan Lasser did at the museum, where, and I think, I feel like I saw it really quickly walking through the museum and I understood it over time, but I think he installed in this really ethnographic context, I could be completely wrong, you can correct me, a really ethnographic context, a piece of Victorian furniture. And when I walked up to the object, I just kept looking at the periphery the whole time. And I was like, I'm looking at African furniture. And then I realized, like, over time, as I left the object, that it was a piece of Victorian furniture. I just couldn't look at anything but the context of the object in terms of understanding what it was. Does anyone recall this at the museum? Do you? And, okay, yeah. So was it a piece of Victorian furniture? Am I? Gothic. Okay. So I feel like that was a really good example of engaging like the context of that object and the history of that object and completely inverting what my expectations were. And you know, I feel like I understood it better the closer to the time that I viewed it. But yeah, there's some. It was engaging the core of what that object was and the context that surrounds it and shifting my understanding of how we understand these objects now through the lens of history. And so that was really effective, I thought. And I wonder, like, how can something like that, not even necessarily looking at context, but how can we think about that related to craft? Because there are things in craft disciplines that are different than, you know, the concerns of sculpture. You know, mm-hmm. they're different. Mm-hmm. So I'm curious, like, yeah. if we were, I mean, in some way it's so obvious, and in some way it's not that obvious to me too, because we're in art departments too, mm-hmm. you know, and I'm talking to craft-based students, I'm talking to not craft-based students all
yeah,
the time.
I think of you as an artist. Too, in your practice.
But my, yeah, I mean, it's interesting because in my mind I do, and at the same yeah. time I'm making jewelry, you know, so there's a yeah. distinction, there's yeah. some kind of distinction that I think is important.
Well, I think that has to do with, if you're going to be critical of something, I think it's your responsibility to take the time to not only understand the context in which it's in, but also the intent of the thing that you're looking at, you know, yeah. so like that's why you're looking at something that's from a product design student different than somebody that's in painting, because their individual intents and concerns and purposes for existing as things are going to be completely different and idiosyncratic yeah. to that individual.
That's an excellent point. So. That seems very like something we just take for granted, really.
Yeah.
But Anya, it's the first question you ask in the critique. You ask, like, what is the objective, and then you ask, what is your research? So finding out the objective gives you a way to understand how to talk about it. Like, whether it's design, then objectives are really different from if it might be craft. Mm-hmm. So you ask that.
I do. Yeah. That's what I do strategically.
Yeah. I've seen it.
I guess I would pose a question off of that, wondering then if critiques where you do not have any type of background on the intention or on the research are as effective for students or even for your own viewing
question.
In the world.
Like a cold read?
Yeah.
Oh,
like,
I love cold reads.
Do you?
I love cold reads. I don't want to know anything about the thing. And oftentimes I've been put in a situation where I actually feel like I'm not qualified to talk about the work. Like I get to go to Cranbrook and talk to a painter. And I'm like, shit. Okay, and then I'm just like, so all I can do is tell you what I already know about myself. Uh-huh. But if I do a cold read, then I'm like, you're going to put this in the world. You made this for the world. Hopefully you wanted to communicate something to the world. So I'm just a sample. I'm just like a little litmus mm-hmm. test. And you can mark down like, well, someone's getting at this and they're not. Mm-hmm. I'm just like a sample of this greater population of people who want to spend time looking at objects. Like that's my mm-hmm. connection, is that I care about looking at things. But I might not know anything about you or what your intention is. And I think that's legitimate if it's useful to the person and they understand, because clearly they understand. I'm like, I don't want to know about you. I'm just going to talk about this.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
That's great.
Yeah.
I agree.
When you make work then, do you work off of the premise that because you're not in this academic setting where critiques are structured for you and led by someone else, that the critique that you are expecting from the world is a cold read? Like, do you make
yeah.
work based off of that premise?
Well, I was wondering if that was where Beth was going, because like now I'm on my own and no one talks about my work except for my kids mm-hmm. and my husband. So it's like, you know, it's a top sell, right? I mean, yeah. And
they
so then once
about
it,
your stuff, that's pretty awesome.
Well, you should hear the things they say. There's quite a bit of disregard there. It's like, couldn't you make dinner instead? Like,
are you done yet?
You made yeah. today? Yeah.
I'm hungry.
Yeah. So that's where I get into trouble, where thinking that the only time it's reviewed really is when it's already in an institution. And what I kept thinking about you, Rebecca, talking about AJF as being a platform where galleries are projecting or
promoting artists who are authenticated and validated. I'm like, well, what happens when the work gets that far? Can you even take a step back and ask if it's any good? And it's the only way that it's good if it sells? I mean, no. Shit, then I'm in big trouble.
Because right. It's not selling.
It's not selling.
Selling is not the only point of validation.
That is not
right. It's a nice one. It feels really good.
Yeah.
Well, but it's hard these... Yeah, go ahead, Rebecca.
Okay. Yeah. So one of the things that you said, Mary, before was mm-hmm. that when you're having a critique, the person who's benefiting often mm-hmm. is the people doing the critiquing because they're learning how to express ideas mm-hmm. and all this stuff, but the artist who's receiving the critique mm-hmm. is learning if what they thought they were doing is working.
Is showing
really
up.
Valuable.
Absolutely.
Because if you know this is happens all the time. You think that you're making a critique on, or you're making a piece about a critique of society and da da da, and people are like, I just see blue.
Yeah.
You know, you as an artist are not communicating your intention.
Right. Mm-hmm.
No matter how much language you heap on your piece, if people don't see it, if it's not, you know, not that it has to be immediately apparent, because sometimes there's layers that you have to a little bit, you know, imply or say or in the wall text or something. But something needs to be communicated. And so that, I think, is one of the most useful things in the critique, is people telling you, yeah, you're way off base. Mm-hmm. Or what?
Yeah.
The really nice critique is when somebody comes in and says everything, as an artist, everything that you thought you were doing. Which then you're like, okay, maybe I'm being too clear. Maybe I should push this idea. Maybe I've done this idea enough. So the critique, I mean, it is, you're, I agree, it happens, the people critiquing get a lot out of it, but so does the artist
mm-hmm.
in this way of seeing if they're being read. Mm-hmm. Which is, I think, well one of you understood a little bit.
I want to go back to this idea of like whether you can critique in an institution, because I would like to hear what the rest of you, I mean, I understand your point, and I'm curious about, I mean, I still critique when things are in an institution, but I also find like the longer I'm in practice, the more surprised I am that I come full circle to things that I totally disregarded like 20 years ago, that I'm now like, oh my God, I get it. You know, and I'm like, well, what if I just am not getting that other thing yet, like 90s teapots, you know, like in 10 years, it's going to be the thing. Again, it's going to be awesome, you know?
But there was no critical rigor around those ever. So I'm wondering about that idea of critical rigor. Like, how do you know it's there? Or, you know, but I'm curious, too, like, what the example is of, that you've come around to 20 years later.
Ellsworth Kelly, before he died. Mm-hmm. I finally got Ellsworth Kelly. Like, I respected him. I learned about him. Full respect. Took him as a part of the historical dialogue. Didn't really viscerally or emotionally ever spiritually connect with the work.
Mm-hmm.
And then I really had like these moments with his work that everything just opened for me. And now I'm like floored by his work in a way that I never was before. And I so that now I'm just like, wow, that's shocking to me. And I count on having more moments like that as I continue to mature, if I'm alive. I'm hoping that other things will reveal themselves to me that I don't know. I don't know that 90s teapots are not good. I don't really know. I think I know,
mm-hmm.
but I might not know, you know? Like,
so is there a need for something sort of beyond critique? I mean, critique's kind of a self-fulfilling prophecy, and as an academic or an artist, you're sort of trained in the discourse, so you don't have to go in and dance that dance and critique anything. Is there something to be thought about that's like a sort of post-critique that's maybe a bit more holistic, or that operates in a slightly less predictive way? I mean, critique implies what it's going to do. Some, you know, going to say something critical or crappy about your work.
Why are you looking at me, John?
Because we haven't sent out your last check yet. But I'm just wondering, are there people sort of thinking about the problem with the whole concept of critique?
Mm.
It's a bit of an artificial construct.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think that's why I don't like the word.
Yeah.
I really, you know, and it's like you finally get Ellsworth Kelly. Yeah. Like to think about that. Or, you know, if I only see blue and the whole room only sees blue, like what's wrong with that? You know, I had, there's, I was setting up a show, and I'll talk about it when I, my energy talk, this Paul Revere project, and I did this show, and the curator, or the gallery curator, said, you realize none of our students are going to understand any of this work, and I said, that's fine. Like, I made it for myself. I was self-critical in the whole process, and I didn't, I mean, you know, I wasn't worried about it, you know, it's, you know, just, I have to understand their intent, you know, they have to, like, make an effort to work, you know, do some work themselves and try to unpack some of my intent, so.
John, your question implies an alternative? Mm-hmm. What is it?
Well, I'm just wondering if there's something that's maybe, you know, again, critique implies a particular type of lens. Well, I don't know as much about the whole notion of crits, for example, but is there another sort of construct that maybe broadens the modes of analysis or the types of conversations that take place that aren't so necessarily bent on critiquing, criticizing, providing some sort of implicitly negative or hard view of the object? I don't know, just...
Yeah. I am very curious about that as well, and I think that... Mm-hmm. That's something that I really want to find out, because I don't think that there is this other.
Yeah.
You know, we all do, everyone sort of does it the same way, if you will.
Right.
And I don't know if we're getting anything new out of this. That's something that's been, like, that I've been thinking about. I'm like, wait a minute, why do we do it this way? Who said we have to do it this way? Can't there be another way? Like, can't we sit around and, like, the point for me is to have my students also learn how to ask questions, you know? That's like...
And to take responsibility,
absolutely.
Because you're an educator.
Right.
And there's that, so you need some kind of way of measuring that.
Yes.
Which has been unsaid, but there it is.
Yeah. But I am like, God, there's got to be something else. You know, like this, why are we all doing it the same way? Is it working? I'm not so sure it is. I'm not so sure. Mm-hmm. I don't honestly think it is in terms of having, I'm talking about crafts, become not something different. I don't want them to become anything different, but to have more of a critical engagement. Maybe? I'm still
having a hard time even just talking about craft as this separate thing. Because if it's not relevant now, it has no meaning, right? It has to be applied to problems of now, or there's no use to it.
Right.
I don't know.
But it makes me think of that contemplative practice that you were talking about.
The third bird exercise.
I know. Can you talk about that a little bit?
That's an exercise in sort of slow looking that Graham Burnett, teaches history of science, history of philosophy at Princeton. He and Sal Rudolph, a New York artist, came up with this sort of four-stage process of looking at art. And it's sort of, you have a card, and there's sort of four different steps: close looking, stepping back, and the group is in the museum. They're wearing yellow scarves to identify themselves, and they don't talk. And visitors aren't allowed to talk to them. So they do this for an hour or so, and then you go someplace and you talk, let it out.
And it's called the Yellow Bird.
The Third Bird.
Third Bird.
I think there's some YouTubes about it.
Okay. I think it's exciting.
It's rooted more in kind of intuitive responses and probably more sort of psychological.
Mm-hmm. But what a difference, rather than, you know, the typical museum experience of sort of sucking in the information label and then marching on, or those people with the headphones of like, there's something I need to get out of this, and then I'm going to go.
It's totally inverted, because the normal museum experience is a one-way conversation, and you're not a part of it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One of the things we do at University of Oregon, I mean, it's similar, but not, you know, the same, obviously. But just going back to the idea of the cold read, I think that's why Courtney's asking that question, because in graduate critique colloquium, which is an interdisciplinary critique class, all of the students across all disciplines are together reading the work cold for 20 minutes, 25 minutes, looking, slow looking, reading the work, reading the language of the work and writing, and then everybody reads what they wrote, and then eventually after an hour and a half there's conversation about the work, and so you have all of this speculative response to the work. And so criticism, yeah, it's not always of judgment, maybe. In that context, it's speculative. And then, so that's interesting. And then I think that, like, I love the idea of coupling all of these kinds of critical strategies, you know, that you get all of these experiences over the course of your experience learning, you know, in whatever context that might be. So that, and then critique that is evaluative, you know, in maybe where we call it critique, it maybe becomes more evaluative with an idea of context embedded in it. But then when we do those seminar conversations, those aren't as critical. I think they're like imagining possibilities. So kind of future thinking on behalf of somebody else. So I love the idea of this like slow looking, you know, speculative reading.
We've already covered like five different ways of critiquing.
Yeah.
You were just saying that everybody's doing the same thing, but it's not true. There's like people, there's the sort of looking, there's outsiders, there's sitting with the piece for a long time, writing about it, and slowly talking about it. And then it's, Anya, you said this criticizing the work through looking through theory. So having people read.
Like in a seminar.
Yeah.
Or just imagining possibilities.
Yeah, these are all ways of critiquing. They're all really different. They all have different results and different levels. That you might want to apply them at, and at you know, too early is probably for some of them are not applicable, you know. But that's a whole bunch of different ways.
I think the problem with critiquing academically and also within workshops, for me, is that it's that artificial construct. While I find it really inspiring in some ways, and rewarding for the people involved. Ultimately, in the end, when the individual walks away and continues to create over the span of their lifetime, you know, like when you're looking at the work that's done within that kind of communal environment, and then it's not necessarily a problem, but it's just, you know, inevitably the voice is going to come out, and the voice is going to be from a place of being alone in a studio some point in the future without 30 other people giving them a completely devoted hour and a half of their lives with all of the creative and intellectual and spiritual energies go. I mean, it's very luxurious to have all of those people.
But that's why you buy that experience and go.
You're
to
buying
school.
Into it, which is good. But then ultimately, you can still go out and make work, and the work is what it is, whether it's critical work in dialogue in a greater way or not, and it's what it is, you know what I mean? It doesn't, and that's the true voice of the individual that comes out after that experience, if it's not so modified by the academic experience that it can find its flow again and come out on the other side. Am I making any sense at all?
Well, I think I'm wondering then, building off that, like, what's your role as an instructor of helping to build that like self-evaluative muscle? So like when you're in studio by yourself, you can have maybe those historic voices come back in, or like how do you know? It's about, I think I wonder about it being about like kind of creating. Helping someone to create self-evaluation as a maker.
I think
maker.
It's important, but I think that the dark side of that is that then it becomes, you know, you find a formula that works in a way of critiquing yourself that shapes why the work looks the way it does and why, you know, I can tell the work that comes out of RISD in a heartbeat. I can tell the work that comes out of VCU in a heartbeat. I mean, SAIC, you know, like I know those artists that have graduated from those.
Are you saying that the institution so thoroughly marks the practitioner that after they leave school they don't have a voice?
I don't think it's intentional,
right?
But I think that there's a zeitgeist that happens in these different pockets and the way that they're lovingly supporting the students going through that practice, and then those students come out the other end and they're making work in a very specific way, and the work is good and it's strong, but it's also it's a known way of working. And I just wonder, because I look at a lot of self-taught art, non-academically trained art, you know, like the authenticity of that voice, it takes a lot longer, I think, to get back to a place of the individual. Huh. Sometimes. I know it's a little pessimistic.
School spoils them.
Not always, but I think the potential's there.
I do.
I think the potential's there. It's just my opinion.
I want to go back to something, John. Like, maybe in a bad way.
Okay.
Yeah. So you said something about intuition. Speaking from experience, no. I feel like that's something, and it maybe even is, sometimes I feel guilty, or it's like a dirty word in academia, but that's what I want to teach my students, is how to trust their intuition and to use that as a tool. Mm-hmm. And so that is part of what I attempt to do in a critique. So when they leave school, they have learned to trust that. So mm-hmm. when that shit comes in, those thoughts are, well, I don't want to say that on camera. Those thoughts that are like rabbits fucking, that multiply so fast,
that's what's been in my mind this whole
time. Or there's like this formulaic way that you've been taught to critique and evaluate your work, that you're not relying on that, mm-hmm. So I do think that I see that as well. I see it more nowadays than I have in a long time.
But I feel like more nowadays.
People relying on this.
Yeah, work that you can tell where it's coming from.
I have a question. You just mentioned intuition. And I personally have no formal training. That's the only place I can come from, truthfully. But if you're in an educational institution that so values the research and everything into it, don't you kind of lose that intuition if you're going to research it rather than just... I'm not saying you can't do both, but isn't there a moment or an appropriate time where intuition takes you somewhere without research?
Can I say that to me, intuition and engagement are related? So that, like, there's something about loving being in the moment of your practice, like the pure joy of being invested and kind of in the middle of something that's evolving. And I think people come to practices in different ways. Like, some people are intuitive, and some, like, for me, it would be research that triggers something that sparks my intuition, actually. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I feel like people work in really different ways. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It could be both, totally. Absolutely. Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
But I do feel like in some way that can be obliterated in school, too, and that's the problem of critique. And also, sometimes I don't feel like talking about certain work at certain times, and suddenly I have to respond. And that, I feel like I really dislike the idea of performing a critique when I'm not in the kind of right mind frame to respond. It's interesting, but you have to. So in that way, I dislike the institutional kind of necessity of it, mm-hmm. That could be interesting to think about restructuring. But I feel like with grads, you have the luxury to be really flexible in the way that you respond to their work. And sometimes you're just, it just feels like a lot of space to figure out what each person needs idiosyncratically, as opposed to a class of 20 or 18 students where, you have to respond like 10 minutes one after the other and you're like, I don't know. It's just a lot to think about all, from one to the next. On a timer, exactly. You're on a timer in critique with undergrads often, So, but I appreciate that idea. Yeah, intuition, it's relevant, right?
It's a tool. I think of it as important. A tool. We have to learn how to use it. So
how do you cultivate intuition in an academic environment? Like, how do you encourage artists to go for that? Like, how would you encourage them to trust it?
That's what I'm still trying to figure out. No, I think... There's a couple of
practice.
Ways.
That's how you learn. Exactly. You practice. You make evaluative judgments and you practice over and over again. You get better at things because you have sustained periods of attention practicing. I think you can practice anything. But I also think that you can practice and take your intuition and do a little research. Just be responsible. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's not like you're free of it's just not like. Well, you are free to do whatever you want, but no one has to give a shit, okay? So you ought to be responsible. Mm-hmm.
I agree with that too, because I do have some students right now who just want to make stuff, and they want to just talk about working hard and making stuff. Yeah. And frankly, that's not the kind of inquiry that you do in an academic institution. Right. There's got
to
be something
that frames...
Because then
you shouldn't have to pay for it. You should just go to your garage and
exactly.
just do it.
Exactly. You don't need this discourse to frame what you're doing. But I'm curious, actually, because I feel like Iris Eichenberg does a good job of teaching students to do that. So from your perspective, what do you feel like happens in that context?
It's a similar model to what John was talking about. You look at the work, somebody like spent hours with the work and wrote something without talking to anybody about it, and then you spend like 20 minutes with the work, and then without the artist saying anything, you just start talking about it, how it makes you feel, what do you think, what do you see, and the conversation goes for 40 minutes, and then it's over. So the artist doesn't have any input, they're just an audience. So then it's that what I was saying before about the artist is learning from the conversation other people are having about the work to see if they're hitting their targets they want to use in that way. And if everybody says blue and they're like, well, I thought it was purple, they're like, well, maybe it's blue, so maybe I should explore blue. But if the person says, no, it's still purple, that's fine too. I mean, they can keep it purple. So I don't know. But Beth's point about, you know, there being a mark of the institution on the artists that come out of it, it's. I hear a lot of people complaining about that because I went to private work, and I think it's just kind of a normal thing when you're like in a group of people who are making work together and talking about the same work together, that the same kind of ideas or material handling or usages happens kind of organically, and there is a big period of unlearning. When you get out of school.
I think so too.
Yeah,
and
you
learned
a lot in school. Yeah, you have to unlearn certain kind of habituated ways of thinking and seeing
or maybe you learn that you just don't need it anymore.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's like the training wheels are off.
Right.
You can let that go.
Right. Yeah. But I mean, like, teaching art is such a hard thing. Like, how do you teach that? I mean, how do you teach somebody to be creative? Practice, right?
Practice, model, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. It's complicated.
It's kind of lovely, though. Isn't it holocarily?
Yeah.
It's a gift. We can complain all we want, but it's a gift, I think.
Well, even to be able to have a conversation like this
this
garden
so nice.
About the idea of, yeah, like this is a really luxurious position from which we're operating. So.
Summer's off.
Yeah.
All right, yeah, you get sabbaticals too.
Best gig out
okay.
there.
Does anybody have
real quick one? Does anybody teach in the defend your work environment? Because we haven't mentioned that as a critique method, but that is something.
Elaborate on that.
Defend your work. Stand with your work in front of a like panel who are challenging your work. It's more of a
that's
like
UK graduate thesis.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's for our grad. Yeah. And when I was at Madison, that was the graduate thesis.
Okay. Yeah, I'm not familiar with that. I've never experienced
absolutely.
That before. So mm-hmm. That was one. That
and there were practice theses where you had to try it out. Yeah. Absolutely.
We do that.
And then
well.
There was a written part
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
That you had to do.
But that's the practice, the written and the oral and the making. It's all. Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, I'm so glad no one brought it up. Now I have to. Like, how many critiques are just about the different professors in the room? Oh, my Lord.
Yeah.
Well, that's, I think, what, you know, sort of what you were talking about when these programs have these, like, very distinctive aesthetics. And I, you know, I think about that, and that's, like, the downside of being critical. Like, when you create those voices in your head, and you're like, you create these biases in your own practice and you lose the intuition and it's hard to like, mm-hmm. why do I keep doing it this way? Because so-and-so said 15 years ago and I can't shake it,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's, you know, I mean, I guess I could open this up to the three graduate students that are here that I work with, and this may be dangerous, but I definitely do my best to, and this is, I guess, understanding intent, like orbit around the work as much as possible to try to get to where they are. Maybe that's the sensitive knowing or looking.
Yeah,
what
sensitive knowing.
Science of sensitive knowing. But because you guys all have very distinct things that you're doing. I mean, there's like barely a thread of connection between any of you other than you're in the same room, which I think is great, you know, but it's also difficult. Like, okay, we're going to go from, you know, this idea to this idea, and it's like, you know,
well, it's interesting.
After 20 minutes, and then like switch gears, you know.
Yeah, it's
like
exhausting. Yeah,
but that's like a way you can evaluate yourself as an instructor in some ways too, right? Like they're all like working in a very different way. So like in some ways, maybe you're like.
I want them to make the work that matters,
you know what I mean?
To them.
But like, that's
it's authentic to them. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so it's not about the professors in the room and whatnot.
Right.
Does anybody have a final thought, question, or need they would like to bring up? Do you guys want to defend yourself in the back there? You're good.
I am curious to hear from students.
Or like new educators, people who are just starting to teach, students.
You guys better.
I mean, the point of this is that we figured this out together.
Because that's on camera.
That's what I mean.
we're in a place where, like, I don't really know what I'm doing, like, what do you care about? Like, what is this point of reference that you're coming from that's like, okay, so if you're not interested in this, what are you interested in? And then, like, come from that perspective, like, trying to make sure that things stay personally important, like, and also within the larger, like, contemporary art culture. But, like, for me, I know it's very important that it's still my work and that it stays coming from this personal frame of reference. I don't know how it would be.
I would agree. I mean, there's nothing I hate more in a critique than someone saying, well, why did you do it this way instead of this way? Because that's what I wanted to fucking back off.
Yeah.
And I think that there's a lot of value in allowing that to happen, and I think that's maybe where some of this school's work looks like this, that school's work looks like this, because those questions come up repeatedly and then you get sucked into it.
And I think we actively, as like a grad community, try to make sure that everyone isn't being coerced into doing something that, like, they don't, that's not necessarily honest to where they want to be working from.
I just want to point out, just to clarify, when I'm saying that there's threads of similarities between different institutions, I don't think it's from coercion.
I don't mean it in a coercive way.
I just
want to
clarify
that.
It just happens, yeah.
And then I wouldn't say it's intentional, but you know.
I think it's because we can only be who we are as individuals, and we can only give what we give, and who we are inevitably is limited.
Mm-hmm.
So, and so I think that's, and when you're critiquing over a period of years in one institution and you're who you are, and your colleagues are who they are, and you're critiquing in the way that you critique, even as you're growing as individuals, I think I can only offer what I can offer as a person from my own perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's
I think I would argue that happens in, like, all academic disciplines, though. Like, if you're a biologist and you're learning about, you know, whatever. Like, I think that
uh-huh.
that's why you have to be conscious about the graduate programs you're choosing, so that you know that you're, like,
well, and with grad students being careful that they pick the committees,
right.
You know, like,
or the institution, right?
Yeah.
I mean, when you're a student, you go and look at different institutions. You have a good idea what's going on there.
Yeah.
And there's you know, a history of lineage,
like journey to
you. Yeah, so part of this conversation about, like, that we're having at this very moment is about I am what I am, and that's who I am. So, and that's a very American, forceful way of presenting, and so, and there's nothing wrong with it, but, like, if you know, like, sometimes your ideas of who you think you are should be challenged, and that can be opening up cracks and stuff, and then you got challenged and you're not sure, and all this kind of stuff happens. So being within a teaching environment or a lineage or something like that, I totally gets complicated, but I think the American, like, kind of resistance to it is kind of from this idea of we have a name for it. It's part of our culture. It's like frontierism, like this independent.
Yeah.
I did it on my own kind of idea.
Where
autonomy,
right? Where, like, in Europe, for example, there's a pride of the lineage, and that, like, yes, you can see this thread. So it's different.
Yeah,
carrying on a tradition.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Rugged individualism.
That's what I was looking for.
Yeah.
Rugged individualism. It's literally like a precept of our entire culture.
Yeah.
It's one of the reasons capitalism is rampant. So, you know, here we are talking about it in art making and what that means to have that thread.
Mm-hmm.
Some people embrace it. Some people don't want it at all, which is fine. Those are choices. That's why you choose the
institution. Your lineage.
I think we can end it there. Does anybody have so thank you guys so much for telling us your feelings and participating in this panel, and thank you guys so much for participating. Today was really amusing, so it was nice to have access to all of your brains.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.